Hey guys, it's Kevin again, and happy 2020 to all of you. But, you know, because of the fact that I am very behind in videos, I'm still in 2019 mode, so I still have a lot of things I need to do. One of them being a much delayed and I think much needed catch-up review. So here's the thing. I actually meant to do a catch-up review back in the summer. I had about like 20 to 30 movies that I could have talked about, but unfortunately I just kept putting it off and I just didn't have the time to do one. I had work and schoolwork and things like that, and I didn't have the time to do it, unfortunately. So I waited till now, and so because of that, you're not just getting one catch-up review, you're getting two catch-up reviews. This is going to be a two-part video, mainly because half of the ones I'm talking about are Netflix films and half are not. So this is going to be the Netflix half, talking about the Netflix films that I've seen throughout the rest of the year that I just didn't have the motivation or have the time to do a full review on. Now, full disclosure, these are not necessarily movies I don't like. There are actually some that I really do love in here that I would have loved to do a full review on, but again, I just didn't really have the time to fit them in there. So without further ado, we're just getting into right now. So this first one I'm talking about is a film that I meant to review back in February. I meant to talk about this on my first catch-up review, but it was one of those films where I wasn't, like, disliking or anything, but I just kind of realized, like, while I was watching it, I wasn't in the mood to watch it. So because of that, I just wasn't very focused on it and things like that. So I knew I had to give it a rewatch before I could fully assess how I felt about it and really come to a conclusion of, like, you know, do I like it? Do I not like it? And I unfortunately never got to rewatch it until now, and it's unfortunate because I actually really enjoy High Flying Bird a lot. And look, I'll just say right off the bat, I am not the target audience for this movie. I am not really someone that's into sports at all. I don't understand sports culture. It's just not something that I've ever really been that invested in. The thing that really intrigued me, though, with this film is Steven Soderbergh at the helm. Definitely anything that he gets involved in, I'm definitely very interested in. Also, it being from the screenwriter of Moonlight, and it definitely delivered for me. Like I said, I enjoyed this one quite a bit. I especially enjoyed, I think, the acting here. I thought all the performances here were very strong. For sure, Andre Holland, I thought, was definitely the big standout. His character, he's very cunning and manipulative, but you can totally see where he's coming from as well. You can understand why he's doing the things he's doing, but he also takes things way too far. And I think Soderbergh did a really good job with writing this character, but just the story overall, I mean, for someone like me, like I said, who doesn't know a lot about this stuff, I think they did a really good job in showing why a lockout is so important, what it could really do, you know, why this puts a player at risk and things like that, and the difficulties that, you know, Holland's character as this agent gets in trying to help him out. I thought they did a really good job with showing that for sure. I thought the script was definitely very compelling and things like that. And that's something that I definitely was really into. I thought that the bond between the two was very interesting, but also his relationship with Zazie Beetz. It did not go in a direction that I was expecting, and I definitely really did like seeing that for sure. But the other big thing to love about this film is that, once again, it's also filmed on an iPhone, just like his previous film, Unsane, and it works really well here. It gives it sort of a documentary-esque feel, and I thought he did a really good job with that. I also liked the cutbacks to these other basketball players, you know, real life basketball players, kind of seeing like where their heads are at, why they love being in basketball, although, you know, how much of a rush it feels to play. And I always find that very fascinating, you know, getting inside someone's head, why they love to do what they do. I think this film did a really good job with that for sure. So again, there's a lot that I really did enjoy about this one. I think Soderbergh's directing, like I said, was top notch here. It definitely felt more like a Soderbergh film, especially more than his other film that came out last year, for sure. So in terms of complaints, I think there's a bit too many characters here. I just think they could have done a lot more with them. Sanja San's character especially, I thought, was very underused. There's an aspect to her that I really wanted to see them dive a little bit deeper into. Same with Zazie Beetz. I thought she was a little bit underused as well. And I think couldn't have done a little more there. I also think the film's just a little bit too short, even though it did drag in certain places for me. I think the film is definitely a little too short for sure. I think they could have definitely, if they would have had like another 20 or 30 minutes, they could have fleshed some things out a little bit more. But overall, I was impressed by this one. And like I said, I'm for someone who's not the target audience, this film impressed me way more than I was expecting it to. And it kind of sucks that I didn't get round to it. I didn't get back to it until now because I really enjoyed this one more than I was expecting. B for High Flying Bird, very solid film. And I think a good way to start off this catch-up review for sure. Definitely better than most of the films I'm talking about here. See You Yesterday. Now, this one is very interesting because I actually filmed a full review for this one. This isn't one that I left out of my last catch-up review, not because I forgot to talk about it, because I simply forgot to put in the footage. I stupidly forgot to do that, so unfortunately, it was left out of there. But yeah, I was actually really excited for this one. You know, the whole concept, I think, is very interesting. The problem with this movie, I think, is that it just isn't very well executed. It kind of feels like two very different movies. Half of it is trying to be something really authentic, trying to be something that's sort of like a cautionary tale, in a sense, showing what happens to, you know, people, unarmed black men and things like that, that are killed. And I think it does a really good job with that. It has some really good social commentary in there for sure. The problem is the other half of this movie is like some more like a grown-up Disney Channel film where they're in, you know, it's a Disney Channel film, like tonal-wise, they're just saying fuck and things like that. And it just doesn't really mesh at all. And I also feel that the actual death is really poorly handled. It's incredibly rushed. They don't really give you a lot of time to process it. And again, the idea of time travel is a cool one, but where the movie ends up going towards the end was extremely predictable and just was very unsatisfying to me. The actors here, they're fine. Like, they're doing a really good job. I really like the lead here for sure. But overall, I think this could have been so much more. I think there was a lot they could have done here. The humor especially fell flat for me. Again, there were some aspects I really did like about it. I like what they're trying to say about like Black Lives Matter and things like that. I like the way they tried to add like a sense of science fiction to it. But unfortunately, I think it's just one of those things that sounds a lot better in concept than it does in execution. And so because of that, it left me feeling rather disappointed. I think it just could have been a lot more overall. I Am Mother, this was one everyone was kind of like raving about when it came out, and I thought it was fine. It didn't really do a ton for me, to be honest, and my biggest issue is that I just think it's far too predictable. If you've seen any films like this where there is this dominating like force and it's this robot and it starts off, you know, really like maternal and sweet and things like that, you know eventually where this is going to go. And so because of that, it just isn't very surprising and there just isn't a lot of suspense there. I will say the main girl I thought was really good. I was very impressed by her. I thought they did a good job with her and her arc and her, you know, kind of, you know, realizing that this robotic force isn't as nice as she claims to be and that there's a lot that she is not letting her in on. I thought that was interesting. Hilary Swank's character, I thought, had a lot of potential as well. I just think she comes into the movie way too late. I would have really wanted them to flesh her out a bit more. I think they could have done a lot more with her for sure. And Rose Byrne is definitely better than she was in Jexy for sure. This is a much better, you know, sort of voice performance, definitely. But again, she does a good job with deceiving you, but she also doesn't, because again, if you've seen any movie ever, you just know where this is going to go. I will say, I think effects-wise, they did a really good job, and performances are really good for sure, but just overall, it didn't do much for me, because it just doesn't really do anything particularly different, and it doesn't do a lot, I think, to stand out on its own. It's really a film that I've pretty much forgotten, so yeah, C for I Am Mother. Nothing offensively bad, but just very, very middle of the road, I think. Murder Mystery. Look, I can say this. This is definitely better than most of Adam Sandler's Netflix comedies. but it's not one that is, like, you need to, like, rush out and see it. It's definitely entertaining. I think him and Jennifer Aniston, you know, they've shown before they work very well together, and that's definitely the case here. There's definitely a fun mystery going on here for sure. It's just, I think it's really rushed. They don't really give you a lot of time to invest in these two, and I really think they should have before the whole mystery goes down. And I don't think they did a very good job of that. And the characters themselves just aren't all that interesting. It's fun. It's nothing that I think, you need to, like, rush out and see. But it's definitely fun. I had it at a B- at first, but it's one that has very much left my head. So I think I'm at a C+ with this one. Better than most, like I said, but just nothing that is, I think is that worth watching overall. Look, I don't mean to harp on, you know, Noah Centineo and how he's constantly doing the same kind of films over and over again, but seriously, man, can you just have any variety in you whatsoever? Because this is getting ridiculous. The Perfect Dates, I think, is easily the worst of the three he's done. It's so generic, and the main character in general just is not very likable at all. His whole idea is that he's the perfect date for girls that can't get a guy or something like that. It comes across as very problematic in that way, and just as a character, he's very unlikable. He's so overconfident, he's so douchey, and you just don't care about him. Him and Laura Morano as well have no chemistry whatsoever. Laura Morano is good in the movie. I don't think she's bad or anything, but they just do not have any chemistry. But at the same time, the romance is so forced, and that's why their chemistry sticks out even more like a sore thumb, because you just don't buy into it. You don't buy that these two would have these feelings for each other. You don't buy that these two would be in this relationship. It just isn't believable at all, and they don't really do a lot on selling you on it, and I just was not very convinced by it. You know, the rest of the cast is fine for what they have. I thought his friend was pretty annoying overall, but just in general, this is so middle of the road to me. Look, the best way to sum The Perfect Date, I started off casting this movie with, actually, rabbiting. This was before Rabbit went away. I started off rabbiting this with, you know, a few of my friends, and pretty much halfway through the movie, everyone bailed. Nobody wanted to watch this movie. And it's one of those films where it's not even because it was that bad. It's just they didn't really care. And honestly, I can't blame them, because it's such a whatever film. It's the kind of film you just watch in the background. You don't really care all that much about what's going on. You just forget about it instantly. And that's really the best way to sum it up. This is easily one of the most generic films, I think, of last year. And definitely a C- for this one. I just did not give a fuck about this one at all. All right, so finally, after quite a few films, I'm finally chumming a movie that I actually like, which is Beats. This is a good movie. It's solid. I enjoyed this one. Right off the bat, I think Anthony Anderson and the main lead have really good chemistry. They're both are going through some very personal things in their life. The main character, whose name is escaping me, but he did a really great job in this film. He's going through a really personal tragedy, especially in the beginning of the film. He experiences something that is pretty much life-altering, and you can see how this really affects him. Anthony Anderson has his own struggles going on in his life, and seeing these two come together, I think, is really well done. The film also does a lot of great stuff about the music business and things like that, which I really did appreciate. And like I said, I think the two leads have very solid chemistry. So my problem with this movie, though, is that I just think it's a little too surface level. I think we need to lean a little more heavily into some of their troubles that are going on. Anthony Anderson's is really well done. I think we get enough with him. The main character, there is a relationship that he is, that is very crucial to the film that I don't think got the proper development that it really needed, and I think we definitely could have gotten more there. The stuff with him and Anthony Anderson is great. The stuff with him becoming, like, this musician is really well done, and the stuff with him and Uzo Aduba, who is also really great in this movie, is really well done. But I just think they need a little bit more focus on this one relation. But other than that, this one was pretty solid. I'd give this one, like, a B. It's nothing I say you need to, like, rush out and watch or anything, but it's certainly better than most of the films I've talked about so far. Oh, The Last Summer, yet another one of those films that is one of those romantic comedies where we got, like, 50 stories going on. And look, I talked about a film like this last week, actually, Let It Snow, that I thought handled this very well. this is the kind of film that is basically what you expect it to be. Now, I will say there is one really solid story here. The storyline between KJ Apa and Maya Mitchell, I actually enjoyed quite a bit. It went a direction that I really was not expecting. And if it was the whole movie, it actually would have been really good. I actually would have really enjoyed it. I thought the two of them had really good chemistry. I thought the story going on, like I said, I was very invested in. And where it ended up going, I thought was honestly really well handled. I was very surprised with the way that was done, but virtually every other story here, I just did not give a shit about, and I just did not think they did a very good job with it all. Some of them are downright cringeworthy, particularly this one storyline involving these two guys. I just really could not stand it all. A lot of the acting here is really just whatever. I mean, again, the acting is not like the worst thing ever, but it's just so whatever in that way. It's not the worst. Like, it's not like a Valentine's Day or something where it's nearly unwatchable, but it's just a film that is basically what you expect it to be, except for this one storyline that is so much better than everything else. And every time we cut back to it, I was getting slightly into it, but every time that we cut away, I just completely lost interest, and I don't think they handled that very well at all. So yeah, there's some things that I can recommend, like I said, those two actors, but really, other than that story, this was essentially what I expected to be. It's a throwaway romantic comedy. If you need something to watch on Netflix, I guess check it out. It's nothing, it's pretty harmless for the most part, but it is definitely quite boring at many points, so I'd give this one like a C-. Not as bad as you'd expect it to be, but certainly nothing I think worth recommending. Oh god, where do I even start with Sextuplets? Look, this is the kind of movie that I was originally going to do like a whole epic rant for, but here's the thing. I feel like I've gone into why I despise Marlon Wayans enough. I really don't have the energy to get into just how I think he's one of the worst filmmakers out there right now. I think everything about him, and especially when it comes to this movie, this is not the kind of film that Marlon Wayans is trying to make because he's passionate about it. He's making it because he needs another comedy to come out, and he needs another paycheck, and it very much does seem that way. It seems like he is trying to take the Eddie Murphy sort of formula, or the Tyler Perry sort of formula, and it really is not working here at all. I mean, you do not for a second believe that these characters are different people. The concept of, like, six Marlon Wayans alone is horrifying, and the film does not do a lot to not make it horrifying, especially when it is particularly the female character that Wayans is playing here. Just absolutely atrocious. I hate everything about her. She's such a just stereotypical, just sassy black woman. And that's the biggest problem with this movie, is that it doesn't do much of anything to make these characters feel more than just cliches. You have the uncle character that he likes to quote like TV shows a lot and talk about how great they are, and he's just awkward and things like that. And then you have this, like, and then, like I said, you have, like, the sassy sister who is, you know, like, in prison and things like that, and she's a badass and all this kind of stuff. And then you have this, like, elderly character who's, like, a midget, and the way they play that storyline up is extremely offensive. Not to mention, this film, of course, has to be a road trip movie because, oh, we haven't seen, like, dozens of comedies that have done that, and it's just absolutely atrocious. Everything about this film I absolutely despise. There's so many things that just don't work here. So many lines of dialogue I couldn't stand. The characters fall incredibly flat. And where it ends up going especially is fucking ridiculous. Where they end up going, the characters they decide to focus on, is really dumb. Because I think if the film had focus on, like, say, that uncle character, I might not have been as annoyed. What they end up doing in the climax of this movie literally makes no sense at all. It really is just there because, oh, we need some sort of suspense going on other than just being a road trip movie. We need some sort of story going on, and it just does not work. And the whole idea, I think, of just him discovering that he has, like, these six other siblings they didn't know, it's so convenient, and the film does not do much to not make it so. Look, is it as bad as 50 Shades of Black? I mean, it's pretty much on par. They both are Fs. They're both some of the worst movies of the year. I think 50 Shades of Black is the one that definitely offended me more, probably because I just knew what to expect going into this. But it doesn't change the fact that this is easily one of the worst films of the year. It's absolutely unbearable, and just, Marlon Wayans, just stop. Like, I know you can be good. I really know you can be good. He's got a movie actually coming out this year that he's not involved with at all. It's not a comedy. It's a more serious film. I'm actually really excited to see what he does there, because I know he can be a good actor. I loved him in Requiem for a Dream. There are films I've seen him in, like, even the first two Scary Movies, I thought he was pretty fun. So just please, just do something that you actually want to make, and not just something you're doing because you just need the money. Like, do something you actually want to make, and I think he can actually be good, because this definitely ain't it, Chief. One of the worst of the year, for sure. Jesus Christ. Falling in Love, while not one of the worst films of the year, is definitely one of the dumbest. I mean, just get a load of this plot. So, Christine Milian, who I normally think is just a whatever actress, and she's really, really bad here, mainly because of the character she's portraying. This is a woman that, you know, when you're on your computer and you get these random ads that are like, congratulations, you've won $1,000 gift card to Walmart, or congratulations, you've won this trip to the Bahamas. Yeah, she actually gets one and believes it for some reason. She believes that she's won this, like, dream house and that it looks beautiful and things like that. And obviously, it's fake. It's completely dilapidated and just falling apart, and the fact that she buys into it in general is so dumb, and everything that she goes through is so cartoony. This feels like one of those films that feels like a Lifetime movie. It really does. It feels, well, not Lifetime, but Hallmark. It feels like a rejected Hallmark movie in that way. And I've said that Netflix, you know, they've been going down a good path, but then sometimes they just want to make Hallmark movies, I guess. And this is the perfect example of it. And the guy that she eventually ends up meeting with, they have almost no chemistry whatsoever. I really did not buy into it, and I just found it to be a very annoying film. I will say, after a while, it's not as bad. Like, for a while, it was one of the worst films of the year for me. But eventually, it does get a little bit better, but I was so just not into what was going on. It was so just whatever to me. There's also this horrifically bad recurring joke involving a goat. And it's like, is this like fucking like 2013 now, when like people were like playing that Taylor Swift song for like that, and using that screaming goat? Like, just stop. Like, it's just, it is the lowest of the low in terms of comedy. The villain here is so cartoony. I couldn't stand her at all. There's a really bad subplot involving her and Jeffrey Bauer Chapman and their relationship that I just did not care about at all. This is just the definition of just a really bad romantic comedy that's easily one of the dumbest of last year, for sure. A definite D for Falling in Love. Really couldn't stand this one at all, and has maybe the dumbest character of the entire year. But the film as a whole, I think, is pretty terrible. The main character is definitely one of my least favorites of the year. I think she's just so spoiled and just naive and just really just fucking idiot. Like, who believes that that's a real thing? I don't really get it, but whatever. It's a movie. I'd give it like a D. I really did not like this one at all. And, really bad for sure. Definitely not anything I'd recommend. Oh God, don't get me started with this one. Look, when I first heard The Tall Girl was a thing, it felt like a joke to me. Like, you watch the trailer and it feels like one of those like Funnier Die sketches, or like something you would see on, I'm currently watching I Think You Should Leave with Tim Robinson. It feels like something I'd see in there. It doesn't feel like a real movie, and it doesn't at all. Like, even watching the full film, it doesn't feel like a real film. I mean, just the fact that they try to make it seem like this is a thing, that people are bullied because they're tall. People have these self-esteem issues because they're a little bit taller than others. Like, no, that's not a thing. There's no situation where, like, a guy runs off because he's scared of the girl being taller than him, or, like, you know, she stands up and, like, the other girls, like, pick on her for, like, this is just not a thing that happens. And I think the idea of it in general is really bad for girls that are on the, you know, taller side, that are a little bit taller, because, you know, I'm sure there are girls out there that are, and it's going to give them really bad self-esteem issues. I think the film is thinking it's helping them, but in reality, it's very counterproductive in that way, because I think it's doing nothing nothing but lowering their self-esteem issues. And the whole storyline where she finds this other guy that's basically the same height as her is just absolutely ridiculous. And there's this, like, love triangle of sorts that starts, and I couldn't stand it all. The acting here is pretty bad. I mean, the main lead isn't too bad. She's, like, the one thing keeping this from, like, an F for me, but, like, everyone else I really couldn't stand all. This is probably the worst I've ever seen Sabrina Carpenter. I thought she was such a just cartoon one-note character who's like the gorgeous sister and things like that, and she's trying to teach her how to like look better, and it's just like this whole thing is just really terribly handled. It's insanely problematic because, again, it's treating girls that are taller like there's something wrong with them, like they're different, like they stick out, when I think, truthfully, this is not a thing that people deal with, and I think that's the biggest problem of this movie. Like, there's other things I could pick on, how it has so many just, you know, high school type cliches that just don't really happen, where you got like the mean girl, you got like this love triangle and things like that. You know, we have this whole thing where like her sister's like far more respected by even her parents and things like that. You know, there's so many things like that, but I think the biggest problem of it all and the most egregious thing with this film is just the message it's trying to send is really bad. It's super obvious. Like, once we got to the end of the movie, you can pretty much predict what the message of this film is gonna be. You know, she's going to embrace the fact that she's tall, and she's gonna realize that, like, she isn't different from everyone else, and it's like, and no shit, like, I could have told you that from the first 10 minutes of the movie, but for some reason, this film is so hung up on this idea, and I just don't understand it, and it doesn't become anything more than just a film that is trying to have this really bad message, but is horribly handled. It's one of the worst high school films, I think, of the decade last year, definitely, of the last decade, for sure. I was constantly appalled by this film. I hated everything that was going on. It's also one of the longest 90 minutes I've ever seen. It's one of those films where, even though it's like 90 minutes long, it is such a drag, and there's a significant portion of this film where you think it's over, and it just keeps going, and it's so boring in that way, and it's easily one of the worst comedies of last year. Definite D- for Tall Girl. Really couldn't stand this one at all, and I think it probably has one of the worst messages I've seen in any high school film, for sure. Okay, here's the thing about Secret Obsession. Is this film terrible? Yes, but even though this film is really bad, and it's very obvious as to where it's going, that it really does feel like one of those, like, Lifetime sort of movies that you'd come across just randomly, there's something oddly fun about it. There's something that is so enjoyably bad about it, just because of just how insanely predictable a lot of it is. Brenda Sohn, actually, I didn't think was too bad here in terms of, like, acting, but definitely her character is just a huge dumbass, and the fact that she is believing what this guy is selling her when it's so obvious that this guy is clearly hiding something, that he is not being truthful with her. That character as well, like, that actor is easily one of the worst performance in this movie. I mean, he does not do even a remotely convincing job of trying to fake us into thinking that maybe he is legit here. Like, it is obvious from the first frame of this movie that this guy has some kind of agenda, and that he is not being honest with her in that way, and the film never recovers from that, really. I will say, the Allstate guy, Dennis Haysbert, I think his name is, actually wasn't too bad here. I thought he definitely was probably the best thing about this movie. He actually did an all right job, but the film in general, it's not scary at all. If anything, it's kind of funny, and where it ends up going, I just think is completely ridiculous, and they do not do a good job with making this stick out. It's so obvious what's going on from the beginning. It's not at all surprising. I called it literally from, like, the first shot of this movie, and, yeah, it's a really dumb film. It's basically what you're expecting it to be. It's, you know, she wakes up in this coma, this guy's telling her that he's her husband, but there's clearly something off about him. You know where this is going. If you've seen any film ever, you know where this is going. D+ for Secret Obsession. Again, nothing too bad. There's something, like, enjoyably bad about it, but definitely bad, for sure. I don't know, again, I don't know why Netflix continues to do these kind of films. Eli was definitely better than I expect, especially for a film that was supposed to be a January release and then was taken off the schedule entirely. That being said, it's still not a very good film. There's a lot of things that just don't really work here. The story in general, it's just kind of boring. Like, watching him have this thing where he needs all these, like, surgeries and things like that, and, you know, he has all this, like, insane treatment. Like, it should be really grueling. It should be very hard to watch, but you just don't really care because there just isn't really a lot to this character overall. They don't do a very good job with getting you into, you know, what's really going on with him. Why is he going through what he is? It just wasn't very interesting to me, and I didn't think they did a very good job with it. And the acting as well. Charlie Shotwell, I thought, was pretty good. I mean, I could have gone without the constant screaming and things like that, but as a child performance, it's actually not too bad, and I thought he was actually doing kind of an okay job. Everyone else, though, I really was not a fan. Sadie Sink was good for what she had. She's barely in the movie, but she definitely does do a good job. And then the twist happens, and look, I actually don't hate the idea of the twist. I think it's interesting. The problem is the film does not do enough, I think, to really set it up for it to really make sense in that way. And because of that, it just comes across as a very throwaway film. Like, it feels like this is one of those films that is only made to set up a sequel. It really does feel that way, because the way things leave off very much seems like they're trying to get a sequel here. I don't think it's going to happen because not enough people watch this film. And I know the majority of people that did, they were just talking about, like, oh, the movie was, like, making them see demons, things like that. It's like, no, the movie's not even really scary at all. There was not a single point where I was even remotely scared of anything that was going on. But aside from I really have not heard too many people talk about this movie, and it's fairly obvious why. There isn't really a lot to it. It's not as bad as you'd think, but it's just not really something that I can overall recommend. I think it is a cool idea, definitely. Like, I like the idea of the twist. It just, other than that twist, they just don't really do a lot to make this work overall. And I just think in general, this film just really didn't work all that much for me. It's nothing really that I think you need to see. Eli's a C. Again, nothing too bad, but just not something that I'd recommend. Finally, a film I like. The King is really good. I really enjoyed this film quite a bit. Timothée Chalamet he's always great, but he does a really great job as King Henry. Someone who is very much, he doesn't show emotions in that way, and he's very dastardly, and he kind of asserts himself into this role that he doesn't even really want at first, but seeing him go from this, a subject of the king to this very manipulative and very sinister kind of figure, he does a really great job with that transformation. And I know it's a very packed year for best actors, but I don't think Chalamet's getting enough attention, because I thought he did a really great job here for sure. Joel Edgerton as well is fantastic in this movie. He does a really great job as King Henry's trusted companion. There's a really emotional scene, especially in the third act, that I thought he just completely nailed, and I thought he did an excellent job with. And those two really do anchor the film. You care about their relationship, you care about what they're going through enough to where, even when there are points where the film feels rushed, which I'll get into, overall, I think they did a pretty good job here for the most part. The one actor that I do have to talk about is Robert Pattinson, because I've heard many people say, some people think he's great, some people think he's bad. I think that he's a little bit in the middle. There are points where he really is working for me, and he's trying to go for something a lot different, but then I also kind of feel like he's doing a completely different performance than everyone else in this movie. Everyone else in this film, they're very stilted, they're very quiet in that way. Pattinson comes in, this is a very showy type performance as the Dauphin, and something about it kind of works for me. Like, I thought there was sort of a charm and fun to it that really did work, but at the same time, it's a completely different performance from everyone else in the movie, so it kind of feels like he's in a different movie. But it's also Robert Pattinson, so it's still a very fun performance, and I think he definitely did a good job with that. The cinematography here is fantastic. The action sequences, especially this one battle towards the end, is fantastically done, and I thought they did a really great job with filming it. There's a lot of great stuff going on there. In terms of flaws with this movie, I just think that there are some things that do feel a little bit rushed, and I do feel this film would work out better if it was, in fact, a mini-series. I think there's a little bit more they could get into, because there's a point where this film goes in a direction where I was interested, but it feels like it's coming too late into the film. The actual ending, while it is definitely effective, while it is one that really does showcase Henry's full transformation and the kind of things that he did, and just how, like I said, just how despicable of a guy he really did end up becoming and things like that, I think it could have been even more effective if they would have spent more time on this certain thing, if they would have spent more time on these characters, because they don't really do that great of a job with it. There are some things that are just completely glossed over. Also, maybe it's just because I like her so much as an actress, but Thomasin McKenzie felt pretty much wasted here to me. I feel like they could have really delved more into their relationship. There's a really good scene with her where she's talking to him about how, you know, he needs to be a king, and how, you know, the types of things that he needs to do, and I thought that was a very good scene, but I just needed a little bit more from them overall. Again, I really did enjoy this one more than I was thinking I would, honestly. I wasn't really that into, I didn't really know if I would enjoy this one all that much, but overall, I was overall very impressed by it. The 2.5 hours really did fly by for me. It's definitely not a film that ever really dragged for me or anything like that. I just feel like there's a few things it could have improved upon overall, but for the most part, I definitely enjoyed this one. Definite B for The King. Very solid film. I think it definitely could have been a great film had they had focused on some things a little more, had the film been a little bit longer or made into a miniseries, but overall, definitely much better than most of the films I've talked about here. Oh man, American Son. Look, this is a film that I really do want to like, because I get the kind of story that they're telling. It's a very harrowing story. It's a story that is very important. The problem is that this just doesn't really work as a movie. And it's kind of similar to Cats. It's not as bad as Cats, but it's one of those things where the source material just does not translate to a feature film. The biggest problem, I think, with this play is that it is far too confined. It's one of those plays where you have these three characters in this one location, and they're awaiting this news. And throughout the whole movie, you have Kerry Washington anxiously awaiting this news of, you know, what could have happened to her son? Was her son killed? Obviously, what could have happened to him? He's just kind of disappeared. She doesn't know what's could have happened there. And then she's dealing with all these characters that are ridiculously unlikable, to the point where it's almost like cartoonishly evil. I mean, Jeremy Jordan, who I normally really like, I think is horribly miscasted here. He's trying to be this like racist kind of, like, this character that doesn't really realize that he's being racist, but he very clearly is. And there's a lot of things that he says that, you know, they're clearly trying to villainize him. And I don't think that's a problem with the script. I think just in general, the biggest thing is that this works as a play. As a play, I can definitely see this being very suspenseful. As a movie, it's just kind of annoying. And you're just waiting for that revelation to happen, because it gets very repetitive after a while. Also, I have to say, for the first 20 to 30 minutes, I was kind of hating this. I thought the racial commentary especially was so in your face, and it was not presented in a good way at all. They were really shoving it down your throat and like beating you over the head with it, and it's just the worst example of a film that is trying to kind of mask the fact that it's not very well written, and it's so it adds in this racial commentary so you'll appreciate it more. And I don't think they did a good job with that very much at all. Stephen Pascal, who plays her husband in the movie, there's something that these two are going through that I thought could have been really interesting, but once they ended up diving deeper into it, again, it all just felt very repetitive. And I think the reason why this works so well as a play is because you're more in a more intimate setting. It feels like you're there, you know, you'll feel the immediacy of it all. And also, stage acting, I've said this before, is much different from movie acting. Stage acting is much more big, it's much more bombastic. There's not a lot of subtleties in stage acting, whereas a movie, you need a little bit more subtlety. And Kerry Washington, I think, did as good of a job as she could as here. She did a good job, I think, in trying to carry this as much as she possibly could. It's not her fault that the dialogue here It's really bad. This is not a good screenplay really at all. And again, it's because they didn't really do anything to change it. They didn't really do anything to make this work and make this accessible to, a movie audience. I think this is just one of those cases where this simply just does not work as a movie. It's way too over the top. It's way too hammy. And again, I think as a play, it would not feel that way. It would feel raw. It would feel like it works because it's a different kind of medium. But as a movie, it just really doesn't. And again, the actual revelation is heartbreaking, and the film does a really good job with that for sure. And again, I don't want to knock on the actors all that much. It's just every single character here feels incredibly cliche, except Kerry Washington. She's the only character that feels like she has a little bit more agency to her. But you're also just as frustrated as her, where you're like, okay, can we just get to the point? Can we stop, going over the same things over and over again? Can we just have this investigator finally come in? Because, you know, you have Jeremy Jordan saying, oh, we got an investigator, you know, he's gonna explain everything to you, we gotta wait till he comes in. You're waiting for him to come in because you just are kind of sick of these people after a while. So again, I don't hate this one. There's a lot that I do respect about it, but it's just one of those things where I just don't think this would have ever worked as a movie, and I think they needed to do significant rewrites to really make this work as one. And so because of that, it's a C minus for this one. Again, Kerry Washington is really good, but everyone else is just really over the top, and it just doesn't really work as a movie at all. So yeah, definite C minus for American Son. But of all of the films that I've talked about in this video, the one that I can definitely recommend the most is The Two Popes. This is a film that I really didn't know if I was gonna like all that much, and it's not because of the talent here, because both of these actors are phenomenal. Jonathan Pryce and Anthony Hopkins, I mean, these are two masterclass actors, and they give some amazing performances here. Anthony Hopkins is really good as, like, the main Pope here, but it's Jonathan Pryce who really stuck out to me. He has a very sort of traumatic past, and because of that, he doesn't really know if he's fit to become a Pope. There's a lot of things that he's done where he feels like, you know, he isn't really suited for this job, and Price does a really great job of leaning into just the uncertainty of this character, someone who is just very unsure if he is really qualified for this position and if he's really ready to step up and do something like that. And I thought he did a really great job here for sure. And the two of them definitely have some of the best chemistry I've seen all year. I mean, I could have watched another hour of just these two having a conversation because it's so fascinating in that way. And I think they did a great job with that. My biggest fear going into the movie, though, was Anthony McCarron's screenplay. And it's easily the best screenplay I think he's ever done. It doesn't feel surface level really at all. There are some things that do feel a little bit too glossed over, but for the most part, I thought it was a really engrossing one for sure. I really got invested in what was going on here. Like I said, particularly when we focused on Jonathan Pryce's character's past and things like that, I thought that was definitely very well done. But also seeing what is required to become a Pope, the certain process that you have to go through, is very interesting, and I think they did a good job with that. But the stuff that I really enjoy about this movie is when you just got to see these two guys just hanging out. Like, at first, yes, it's very professional, you know, they want to keep things in a very professional sort of manner, but after a while, they get very comfortable with each other. You see them just, you know, going on, like, they're jumping out of planes, and, you know, you see them playing the piano to Beatles music that they both really do love, or watching football together. I mean, it's just really fun to watch. There's something that is actually, it's actually a lot of fun, and that's something I wasn't really expecting from this film, but there's a lot of comedy in here, and for the most part, it really does work. I didn't think that there were many jokes that really did fall flat here. I do think there are some points where the film does go on a bit too long. It did take me a little while to fully get invested into everything, but once it got great, it pretty much stayed great from there, and I think it only gets better as it goes along. And as a story about you know, the current Pope and sort of his journey to become one, I thought was really effective in that way. It really makes you respect are, you know, the current Pope a lot more and things like that. And I thought they did a really great job with that here. Overall, I was much more impressed by this film than I was expecting. I don't think it's like one of the best of the year or anything, but if both Hopkins or Price were to get nominated, I definitely would not be against it because I think they both did an excellent job here. I think the screenplay here is rock solid. Definitely a lot better than I expected to be. I actually really enjoyed this film quite a bit. Definite B+ for the two Popes. Like I said, out of all the films I've seen, this is the one that I can definitely recommend the most. I think it's very much deserving of all of its praise and things like that. I very much had a great time with this one. And the final film I'm going to be talking about, at least in this catch-up review, is the film I Lost My Body, which I know a lot of people have been talking about. And I'm not going to lie, the first time I heard about this movie, I didn't really know how it was going to be. It sounded a little dumb to me, what we're just like following around this severed hand and things like that. But it's actually a lot more than just that. In fact, I think the stuff with the severed hand is actually the best part of the movie, because it really plays into this idea of us, you know, basically us trying to overcome something that we've lost and learn that we don't actually need it in that way. The hand is kind of a metaphor, and I actually really do love that idea. And watching this hand, you know, trying to get back to its master, there's something oddly riveting about, because you know eventually that this and our main storyline of, I think his name was Nafaldal or something like that, them trying to, you know, those two things are going to intersect eventually, and they do a really good job for sure. And what I thought they were doing throughout a good portion of the movie is that our main character is suffering through this very difficult loss. He has been an orphan throughout most of his life, and he doesn't really feel like he's gotten the proper closure with his parents and things like that, and he's also obsessing over this girl, but he also has this really bad social anxiety, and it's a really interesting story. They do a very good job of getting you introduced to this character, you know, showing his situation, what he's been through, all that kind of stuff, how much his parents played a role in his life, what they did for him. It's very tragic stuff, and I thought they did a very good job with that. There's a really great scene with him talking to the girl that he is, you know, head over heels for about, you know, what could happen if they had different outcomes and things like that, and if they were able to, you know, do different things. And I thought it was a very interesting scene for sure. The animation here is drop dead gorgeous. I thought they did a really great job with it. It's not anime, but some people may think because it's an animated film and it's foreign that's anime. I wouldn't really call this anime at all. It's very much its own thing. It has its own kind of style to it. And I thought they did a really good job with that for sure. So again, all that's really great. Performances are great. I really liked all of the characters here. So I do have two problems with the movie, though, that really do bring it down from being something great. One is that I just think it's a little too short. I think if this film was 100 minutes long, at least 20 to 30 minutes shorter, I think we could have gotten a lot more done here. I think we would have had a lot more time to focus on everything, because I think especially the third act, it just felt very rushed to me. It felt like he eventually gets with the girl, and then things end up going sideways pretty quickly, and I think they just need a little more time to flesh that dynamic out. And also for me, like I said, I liked the idea that the severed hand was a metaphor. And I'll just say, at the end of the movie, it isn't exactly that, and I was a little bit disappointed, but the ending itself I thought was very effective. I like what they were trying to do. I think the character goes on a pretty interesting journey, and overall, I can just applaud this movie for just how different it is. This is the kind of animated film that isn't trying to pander to really anyone. It's trying to be something a lot more different, a lot more philosophical, and I think that's going to throw some people off. But for me, I found it very fascinating. I really liked what they were trying to do here, and I think it's a film that just isn't really getting enough attention, so I think it's definitely worth checking out for sure. I'm definitely going to give this one a B. It very much surprised me, and I think it's definitely a very solid animated film, and one that I think will definitely impress you for sure. And with that, guys, that is it for the first half of this catch-up review. Now, I'm going to tell you guys right now, the next part of the catch-up review is probably going to be done over a period of a couple days, because I got a lot of films to cover. There's still a few that I want to talk about that I have not gotten to yet, so definitely look forward to that. But that's it for this video. Hope you guys enjoyed it. We'll see you guys in my next video, and we'll see you guys for that. Okay, bye.